guy's done a fantastic job. He was just an awesome guy, and I learned a lot of stuff. So again, thanks for coming. I know the family appreciates it very, very much. Virgil was born in Oklahoma City to Lydia Penn and Don Hugh Blake. He served proudly in the United States Army. Virgil is preceded in death by his parents and his son, Mark R. Blake. Brothers Arthur and Rodney. He is survived by his wife, Reba, and they are married, what did she say? What was it? 55 years and 3 months? 2 months, okay. I remember that from the funeral. I thought, 55 years, man, that is a long time. That's a long time. A daughter, Debbie Wayne Clonger. Brother, Bill and Sharon Blake. 6 grandchildren, Reverend Mark Freeman and Candace. Brittany and Levi Gilbert, Michael and Michaela, Lively, Morgan, Cassidy Lively, Devin, Reverend Megan Clonger, Brandy Clonger, 4 great-grandchildren, Canaan, McLean, Hayden, and Everly, and many other family and friends and members. We extend a welcome to the other pastors that are with us today. We say thanks for being here, guys. We really do appreciate it. Let's start this off with prayer today. Good. Father, we're so thankful, Lord, for this day. Taking a moment to praise you, Lord, for the life of Brother Blake, for the impact he had on so many people, Lord. Father, we just take a moment. We pray for the family and we hold them up. We ask God that you administer your peace and your strength to them. I pray, Lord, that today as we remember and as we share, Father, that the glory would go to you, because I know that's what he'd want. So, Father, I pray again for your presence to be here for the remainder of this celebration. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you.
enjoy life. Probably never met a person that I can honestly say enjoyed life any more than Virgil Blake. And I'm honored today to be here with Sister Debbie and Mark and Brittany and all the family, and you all that are here today, and share a little bit about Mr. Blake, and tell you a little bit about what I knew about him as his pastor. Brother Sister Blake moved here from Oklahoma and attended our church for about 12 years, and was very, very faithful. We had the privilege to serve as their pastors and be a part of their life, and they'll be a part of our lives, and that's the way I think God intends for us to be. He and Sister Blake were very faithful to church, as much as their health would allow them to be, and for many, many years that was very, very often. The old three times a week, they were there. Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night. You could bank on the fact that they were going to pull in the parking lot and be at church with us. They were involved in Sunday school. They were involved in the senior arm group, senior adults really matter group. They was always at revivals. They loved gospel singings. And they were always, you know, just sing a little bit and get a crowd, right? Amen. And Brother Sister Blake loved good Southern gospel music. And they were always there coming, always asking me, when are we going to have the next group? And they loved to come. We loved them to be there. They always shared with anything that was going on in the church. If we were having a picnic or a dinner or all family fest day, everybody's working and having fun and enjoying, they'd be there. They might be over to Cape Walk with the senior arms. Now I'm over to Cape Walk with the senior arms. Yeah. Used to be over there where all those kids was playing, but now I'm over there where all the seniors are sleeping. I mean playing. And so Brother Sister Blake, they were always involved in it. They liked to be a part of whatever's going on. Brother Blake loved men's fellowship. He always liked to come to men's fellowship and be there with us and be a part of it, enjoy it, share with us, and of course eat. You know, all churches have eating meetings. And so everybody likes to go to those. He was always faithful. Because he liked to be around the guys. He liked to talk and share. And he shared about things that he used to do in Oklahoma at the church where he served in that ministry and worked in that ministry. You couldn't have asked a family to be any more faithful to church in reality. In all reality, you really couldn't. I mean, what? I mean, you go to revivals, you go to the singing, you go to the dinner, you go to the ladies' meeting, the men's meeting, you go to church three times a week. Unless you make up something else to do. What else could you do to be a whole lot more faithful than they were? They were just that way. It appeared that physical sickness and anything of that nature would be the only thing that would deter Virgil Blake from being in church. And I can honestly tell you, I know that he was in church when he didn't feel good. You know, lots of people can't say that, but he did say that. He was there. He would try to be there. The thing that might keep him out more than his own would be his wife. As you watched in the photos, you noticed and picked up on that. Virgil Blake was a caregiver. He loved his family. He took care of, helped take care of Sister Reba. Even when they lived here, he was there, taking care of her. If he wasn't in church, that was the reason why. Now, the Bible scripture that comes to my mind that I think about when I think about Virgil Blake is Psalm 84 and verse 10. I want to read that verse. Psalms 84 and verse 10. For a day in thy courts is better than a thousand. Here's the part that tells you about Virgil Blake. I had rather be a doorkeeper in the house of God than to dwell in the tents of the wicked. Now, if you came to Trinity Chapel, the first person you see wouldn't be the pastor. Wouldn't be the deacons. Wouldn't be the Sunday school teacher. It'd be Virgil Blake. Because Virgil Blake was going to be at the front door. Now, sunshine and rain. Right? He was going to be there. That was the place that he liked to be and he wanted to be. And he served there for probably 8 or 10 years or 12 years that they were there. Virgil Blake was at the front door. And being the doorkeeper of the house of God. I don't think there was probably anything he would rather do for the church that he was a part of than to serve as a care minister at the front door of the church. Now, he would help in any other way, and he did. He was there some on work days. He was there in other capacities. And if I asked Virgil Blake to do something, if it was at all in his power to do it, but his love was to serve at the front door. And serve he did, Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night. I wondered a few times if he went Thursday or Friday night, and I went there. Because he liked to be at the front door. And he'd have the bulletins in his hands and a big old smile on his face. He served there until they moved back to Oklahoma. That's exactly how long he served. Right up to the last service they were there, he was at the front door. He was friendly always. Smiling, laughter was a huge part of Brother Blake. If you would say something about Brother Blake, I think you could say gentleness and kindness and friendly. Smiling. When service time came, you could find him on his feet after the doors were closed and everybody's in the sanctuary. The next thing you'd notice about Brother Blake would probably be he'd be on his feet with his hands in the air, praising God. He was a pastor's amen point. And Debbie helped me with that this afternoon when I got here. You know, now that I'm past 40 years old, barely, my memory's not as well as it used to be. But I kept telling my wife there's something that Virgil Blake always would say when I was preaching other than amen that I thought was so unique. And he'd do it at the right time and catch everybody off guard. And I'd be preaching up a storm and he'd say, think about it. Yeah. And sometimes he'd point his finger up at me. I'm thinking, does he want me to think about what I just said? What's going on here? He'd say, think about it. And he'd say that a lot of times during a sermon that I was sharing with the congregation. He was loyal to his Lord, and he was loyal to his church. Virgil Blake, now y'all know where I'm fixing to go, and we'll take another turn. Second thing really major about Brother Blake in my mind, not only was the fact that he was a man at the front door and that he'd rather be a doorkeeper in the house of God than anything else, Brother Blake was a blessed man. Anybody ever heard him say that?
Yeah.
I mean, he said that not too many days before he went over to be with the Lord. I'd almost, and I can't be a bad man since I'm a preacher, but I'd almost bet that if somebody asked him while he was, you know, sick or hurting or whatever, how are you, Dad, or how are you, Papa, whatever you refer to him, he'd probably say, I'm blessed. He always said that, no matter what. I tried him out every time, every Sunday morning. I tried him. I'd come in the front door and I'd say, how are you, Brother Blake? He'd say, I'm blessed. And I tried to trick him once in a while. I couldn't trick him. Boy, you couldn't get him not to say, I'm blessed. Here's the kicker. I believe thoroughly that he believed that. You might say, that's just something somebody says. You know, it's like somebody says, how you doing, Rodney? And Rodney said, I'm okay. How you feeling? I'm feeling fine. Like it's just a casual response or reply. I don't think it was, my brother Blake. I really believe that when he said, I'm blessed, in his heart and his mind, he was convinced. In sunshine or clouds, in good health or bad health, in riches or in poverty, everything going good or nothing going right at all, if you ask him how you're doing, he'd say, I'm blessed. He had a family faithful to God, fulfilling the call of ministry on their own lives. You see that in the grandkids today. Maybe in the grandkids. I'm telling you, he died a blessed man. For him living, he was blessed. For him dying, he was blessed. To the family, I want to say this afternoon as I close, you can be certain. I know that you can be certain of this. You can be proud of Virgil Blake. You can be proud of your dad, your granddad, however he was related to you. You can be proud of him because he was proud. He was proud of his children. If there's anything that he liked to talk about, it's his kids and his grandkids. His children. Brag about Rick and Sam. Brag about Mark. Brag about Mark. He told me up at the house several times. That morning, he takes something apart and put it back in. And he said, I'm just thankful he put it back in. Because he sure enough will take it apart. He was proud. So I'm going to close by saying this to the family. You're blessed. and blessed to have him in our life. And we love him. We love Sister Blake and our prayers.
Teenage years, I had moved to California, and about a year later, Virgil moved out there with me. And he stayed out there for about a year. Moved back home because he's homesick. He met the love of his life, and her name was Rita. He met the Lord of his life, Jesus Christ. My brother Virgil was kind of a private kind of guy, but he really had an affection for his quiver, his family, and his wife. And from the time he became a Christian, I would visit him. And like the pastor said, there wasn't a time that I would ask him how he was that he didn't say it. He was truly blessed. Yes. Thank you for the evening.
First of all, give obedience to Father God, then to a man called Jesus. So that to be part of this celebration of my brother, my pop, my friend, my neighbor. 12 years that he was my neighbor. We never called each other by our name. We just say name. And I was asking the good Lord to give me a scripture that can describe him. And as I was saying, I'm in the talking about waiting for this time to begin. I looked over and I seen where it said Luke 14 and 23. And I'm just going to read this to you. And I'm not going to be before you, Lord, but I just believe in you all as necessary. Because God has a plan for all of our lives, whether we're part of it or not. But I'm just so thankful today that God put Brother Blake in my life. You know, and I realize this, church, that we're like seasoned to people. We come in and out of their lives. And I'm just so thankful that he gave me Brother Blake because he has been a blessing to me and my family. Now, if you don't have this your Bible today, just remember this, Luke 14 and 23. 14 and 23 reads, "And the Lord said unto the servant, Go out into the highways and hedgeway and compare them to come into the house of the house may be filled." That's the thing that I took from Brother Blake, that he will go into the community, walking his dog, just telling somebody about a man they call Jesus. And the preacher said, there was never a dull moment around him. You could never know when the man was sick, when he was down, because he had that spirit. And then I grasped really what he was saying when he said that, "I'm blessed." It wasn't about the money, the financial situation. It that he has found his Savior.
Amen.
And I'm talking about a man that who looks high and looks low and got it out first wherever we may go. So we have a lot to be thankful. We should be celebrating this day for this man tonight because he has set some example before us.
Amen.
For me, I can say because he gave me the word that people ask me now about my life, and I tell them, all is well with my soul. Sometimes people look at me and say, what did he just say? All is well with my soul. Now I'm talking about something, no matter even if it's going down, it's still all well with my soul.
Amen.
See, we get, sometimes we get this thing twisted. We want to be all is well with our soul, then things are gone. But I'm a kind of person in church, I want to confuse the devil. Even when I'm down to the downers, I'm still giving God the praise.
Amen.
And now I'm confused. I'm saying, what in the world are you doing down so low and you still giving God the praise? Because I'm faithful.
Amen.
2,000 years ago, man called Jesus on the cross, a Calvary. So that you and I may have a right to live your life.
Amen.
I'm so thankful. I'm so thankful to be a part of this family. So we have to be careful. We have to be mindful of people that we're around, things that we're saying, things that we're doing, places we're going. Because I realize if I can't say nothing for Jesus, I'm not saying nothing. Tell people all the time, that word, when you don't say nothing, K-Y-L-S, keep your mouth shut. I realize this, church, that the Lord is on his way back for his church. Ask yourself this question to yourself. If God come back right now, are you ready? Is everything in order with you? I can truly say to me, I'm thankful. I'm grateful for all that God has done, doing, and going to do. So I say to you, family, keep your hands in God's hand. Let him lead you to where he wants you to go. Because I found out if I want to go where I want to go, I'm going to mess it up. But I know a man that said hi and look low, guide our footsteps wherever we may go. And they call him Jesus.
Amen.
He's your way maker. He's your mind regulator. He's your heart fixer. He's your all in all. He's all that we need. I said, Jesus, do you know the man that says I ain't no go? Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. There's a reason for the season. Brother Mark, Papa's proud of you. I'm proud of you. So you just keep doing what you're doing for the Lord. No matter what anybody may say or do, man, because people are going to try to stop you. When I say people that are not of God, those are single people. What happens sometimes when I'm up, single teaching to our future, and you see just what God's fixing to do, then you'll say things in your life and try to throw you off course. Martin, keep fixing those lawnmowers and all that stuff you tore apart, all that old wagon you built. Ride by my house with your papa. I get all those things, man. But I just want you just to keep that in your heart. The thing that you told me last night at my house, you just keep that close to your heart, man. I told you last night, God has something for you. And it's for you. And it's only for you. So let God use you. God uses who he chooses. And he chose you. And today, I say to my good friend, not goodbye, but see you later.
Yeah.
On the other side.
Amen.
And your favorite word, be blessed.
Wow, thank you for that. I appreciate that. I can follow that. Goodness. I'm going to say a few things for Michael and Morgan real quickly. And then you can hear from me again here in a moment. You know, Michael didn't have anything written down here because he's like me. We both had a tough time with formulating words and thoughts. You know, as far as, I put some things on paper, and you're going to see me do a lot of reading here in a moment of things that the Lord gave me, but I didn't feel like I could stand up here and really adequately portray who Papaw was to me. Michael kind of had like the same sort of thing for him, and I just want to say, you know, people have mentioned me, people have mentioned Brittany and Morgan, but I love you too, Michael, a lot. Being sort of the middle kid, you know, I'm the oldest, Morgan was the youngest, Brittany's a girl, and he kind of gets lost in the middle there, so Papa loved you very much. He's very proud of you. You asked me more than one time what he could do to help you, and if I would remember you in prayer,
new things, letting us do things we shouldn't be doing. That's what Papal's are for. That's how we were running areas and listening to the gangers were the best. I remember when Papal and I built a wooden trailer for me to pull behind his lawn mower, and I used to drive out of the house a few blocks away. Yeah, he wired brake lights to that stinking thing, too. That was amazing. The last 4 or 5 years, Papal started getting sick, in and out of the hospital. It was very hard on me. I've never seen him in pain or hurting, but when Mama was in the hospital the same day he went in last time, Mama was in there a year to the day on January 13th, the same day Papa was admitted this year. He told me when we were sitting in the hospital, "I hope you get to kiss her as many times as I got to kiss my wife." So I kiss my Papa never let my Mama fight anything alone, so the night he got promoted, I made him a few promises. That's what Morgan said he would do. "I'll kiss Cassidy as many times as you kiss Mama. I'll protect and take care of Cassidy," who he called his granddaughter. "I'll never let Cassidy fight a battle alone." Watching their relationship growing up, Mama Pepples was the best thing to be around. It taught me a lot about how to treat Cassidy. I'll never forget him asking what I built lately. He asked me to see pictures of things I've made and how every time I took a project up to him from welding school, I knew it was the last time I would see it because he'd want to keep it. I always told him he was the one who taught me everything about woodworking. He's the reason I enjoy carpentry the most. He smiled every time I talked or showed him pictures of the coffee tables for their other projects that I've made. They have a couple for us too. He's like, you know, he's cheap labor. Morgan said he enjoyed taking them on little trips and it was fun and they enjoyed them very much. They loved going to Brahms and Walmart. He said he remembers taking them to Walmart and Papa and Mama were literally running over everything in their electric carts. We always knew if Mama and Papa weren't feeling too good, they'd eat burritos or Taco Bueno. Even if they turned down everything else, they never turned down a good burrito. Like you need a good American. The rides were wonderful, the smiles, the happiness, the joy you could see. He was proud of us all. He always bragged on all his grandkids and he loved telling others about us. This is a celebration for Papa. He's dreamt of being with his son again for years. No matter what Papa was going through, he would always tell you, "I'm blessed." He was the perfect example to go off of, and I'm so glad I have the rest of my life to use his examples and to one day tell my children about Papa and just how blessed he was.
If you knew Papa, you knew he loved big. He loved Jesus, his family, and everyone he met. So all of you here today, he loved you. He was so much more to us than just a grandpa. He was like a dad. He taught us to fish, ride bikes. He taught us what was important in life. We are so privileged to have had an example of what a real man is like. Someone who is committed to his family, devoted to his wife, and surrendered to Jesus. I'm so unbelievably sad to think about life without my papa, even though he isn't gone, it's just in another place. But I'm hopeful that we will carry on his legacy. My brothers are all strong and confident men because of the example my papa set for them. Mark, you were papa's first hot rod. You brought about a new joy in a very dark season. You were so much like papa. You not only love the word of God, but you study it and make him out every time you preach a message and mentor your students. I know he would beam with joy watching you love your family as an amazing husband and daddy. Michael, You and Morgan not only inherited his receding hairline,